Would you please rise for the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to this regularly scheduled meeting of Bowling Green City Council. Thanks for coming out tonight. We're happy that everybody's here. Kay, would you please begin by calling the roll?
Osbacher.
Here.
Gaverone.
Here.
Gordon.
Here.
Jeffers.
Here.
McComber.
Here.
Roland.
Here.
Zanfordino.
The minutes from the regular meeting that was held on May 16th, 2016 were presented to council prior to this meeting. Are there any corrections or amendments to these minutes? Seeing none, is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, same sign. The motion passes. The minutes are approved as presented. Okay, do we have correspondence this evening?
Yes, from Finance Director Brian Bouchong is a listing of budget transfers to be made for this month, and they were distributed to you prior to the meeting for your approval.
Is there a motion to approve the budget transfers?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion passes. The budget transfers are approved as presented.
And also distributed to you prior to the meeting is the financial budget summary report for the month of May 2016. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Kay. Moving into our official reports, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Mr. President, members of council, and all assembled. I'm happy to report, and I'm sure Kristen Otley will be giving you a more complete report. A little pressure there, Kristen? Huh? That summer programming at the Bowling Green City Parks is going exceptionally well. We had a good first lunch in the park this past Friday with more than 150 in attendance, and we're grateful to So and Amal Shaheen of Southside 6 and their children who provided the food offerings. The weather was ideal. I take credit for the weather. And when the weather is good, we know that business will be brisk at the city pool and the water park. Is that right, Sandy?
That's right.
Okay, because we've seen each other over there, right?
Yes, we have.
But you're really taking it seriously. You're in the water. I was standing on the side. So I encourage your participation, if your schedule permits, this Tuesday, June 14th. Not meeting tomorrow, but another week there, beginning at 10 a.m. in the area between the Wood County District Public Library and the Wood County Senior Center, right out here in the street. We kind of, with the police chief's blessing, I guess we can close the street down for a few minutes. Is that right? It's our National Flag Day, and that means pause for the pledge day, when we will not only honor our national flag, but our city's first responders, the men and women of the Bowling Green City Police and Fire Divisions. That special ceremony will be immediately followed by the declaration of a World Elder Abuse Awareness Day on Wednesday, June 15th. So there's two things there will be taking place here next Tuesday on the 14th out here on the street. Sunday will mark the start of Buckeye Boys State on the BGSU campus, and I will extend greetings on behalf of our citizens at the assembly on Monday evening, beginning at 7:30. We are proud of the fact that Boys State is being held in Bowling Green for the 39th year in a row. And I remain optimistic that Boys State will continue to be held at BGSU over the next 5 years. I encourage you and our fellow citizens to attend the evening assembly programs. All evening programs are open to the public at the Stroh Center and feature prominent speakers and always the truly outstanding Buckeye Boys State Band. You sense a little pride in that, of being in the band with the Buckeye Boys State there. And of course, speaking of the band, as Kristen will tell you, the Bowling Green Area Community Band will be performing on Sunday evening, the 12th. See, I was ready to say it this Sunday night, but the 12th. And I hope you might be able to attend that program there starting at 7 o'clock. I do have some additional appointments to the boards and commissions for your consideration, and confirmation as follows. And I believe you have that list in front of you, but the clerk of the courts, the clerk of counsel requires that I do read it into the record here. So new appointments, Bowling Green Housing Agency, Alicia Nadanovich, a four-year appointment. Alicia replaces Denise Neese, who came off of the housing agency due to term limits. Alicia currently serves as sales manager at Brookdale Bowling Green, an assisted living and memory care center. She has an undergraduate degree in gerontology from BGSU and recently became a certified dementia practitioner. The City University Relations Commission, Shannon Orr, Dr. Shannon Orr, it's a two-year appointment. Dr. Shannon Orr will replace the Reverend Mr. Thomas Malott, who recently left Bowling Green for a like position in Findlay. Shannon is an associate professor at BGSU in the Political Science Department. She has been an active member of this community, working most recently with the Parks and Recreation Department on the five-year master plan. The Human Relations Commission, Cassidy Woodbury, a one-year appointment. Cassie is entering her junior year at Bowling Green High School. She is active in the Gay Straight Alliance and the Advocating for Change. Cassie was highly recommended by both the faculty and the staff at the high school. And Mr. Superintendent, I assume that includes the superintendent. Francis, is that okay? Okay. The Human Relations Commission also, the appointment of Angelica Megacy, a one-year appointment. Angelica will fill the unexpired term of Gloria Enriquez Paisana. She is a 2010 graduate of BGSU and is an intervention specialist for grades K through five at Kenwood Elementary. Angelica also serves as an interpreter for the Bowling Green City School District. The Parks and Recreation Board, this is a five-year appointment, Robin Veach. Robin will take the place of Kent Strange, who recently came off of the Parks Board due to term limitations. Robin is an assistant director of financial affairs in the BGSU Athletic Department. She is a 1990 graduate of BGSU and has resided here for 41 years. Robin is responsible for all athletic transactions through the University Foundation, handles business and recruiting travel reimbursement. Robin is also the personnel director for the department, handling all HR issues with coaches, administrative, classified, and student workers. The Traffic Commission, a familiar name, Kent Strange, a four-year appointment. Kent will fill one of two open seats on the Traffic Commission. He most recently served 11 years on the Parks and Recreation Board, and he will be representing the east side of Bowling Green and we have one additional appointment that needs to be filled on the east side, Daniel, and we've got something in the works right there too. Very soon. But that's open right now. Mr. President, members of council, that concludes my report. If I just want to take a moment of personal privilege, though. I see a face in the audience here that we have not seen in one time, for some time here, I should say. And David Montague is here, back from Bangladesh in one piece, I think, David, right? But David, welcome back to your community here. Thank you. Thank you very much. Unless you have questions.
Are there questions for the mayor? Seeing none, is there a motion to approve the appointments to the various boards and commissions as presented by the mayor?
So moved.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion passes. The appointments are approved as presented. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Municipal Administrator, Ms. Treader.
Good evening. I think we may have mentioned to you at a previous meeting that there were some changes at the Downtown Bowling Green organization, of which the city is a part. I am a board member there. And I am so pleased this evening to introduce to you Mary Hinkleman, who is here. She is the new managing director for Downtown Bowling Green. We hope that you will be seeing her throughout downtown and have involvement with her in various ways. We're so excited to have you on board. So thank you for being here this evening, Mary. The mayor mentioned Boys State, and I am pleased to announce that the city will once again host representatives from Boys State over here They visit here to learn about city government. They have certain representatives who are part of city government, and they come here to learn about how to run a council meeting, how to put together a budget, to learn about leadership. They get to go out with our department heads and see various things, be police chiefs, fire chiefs, all sorts of things. So it really is a nice opportunity for our staff to interact with them, and we enjoy that day very much. Heather Saylor is not here with us this evening, as she's representing the city at the International Town Gown Association in Chicago. This morning, she and a representative from BGSU presented the success of Not in Our Town Bowling Green to the entire conference. So we'll look forward to hearing about that when Heather returns. She may have some other good news for us too, but I don't want to steal her thunder. And speaking of Not in Our Town, the next Coffee with a Cop is scheduled for Wednesday, June 29th. That'll be from 8 until 10 a.m. at Big B Coffee here in Bowling Green. This is an opportunity for anybody to come out, to ask questions, voice concerns, discuss how the police can better serve you and your neighborhood. And the first event that we had a month or so ago was highly successful, and we hope that people will join with us, keep the conversation going. Those of you who frequent our downtown have likely noticed a lot of activity in City Parking Lot Number 2. That's the lot that's located behind CMB's and Prospects on the other side of it. Also where we all gather at the Black Swamp Arts Festival and listen to music, that lot. Work has been ongoing for several weeks, and it will be continuing throughout the summer. The work will result in new lighting, needed utility work, and another significant change: the transition from parking meters to a parking kiosk system in that lot. The decision to move from parking meters to a kiosk system has been considered for several months. There are numerous advantages to the kiosk system, including aesthetic enhancement, improved efficiency for lot maintenance and enforcement, and long-term planning for our downtown parking program. It's hard for those of us that have been around for a while to believe that Heritage 2000 has been finished for over 15 years. Public Works has recognized and been planning for upgrades to city-owned areas in the downtown, including the resurfacing of all public parking lots and the eventual repaving of the downtown in the next couple of years, and we've shared that with council previously. As they look to the logistics on how to pave City Parking Lot 2, which will be the first one that we'll do, they ask the question, does it make sense to pave this lot and then literally punch holes all over the entire lot? Added to the consideration is the extensive effort that goes annually into removing parking meters and concrete blocks each year for the Black Swamp Arts Festival. So it seemed like a good time to critically look at making a change. Working in coordination with the police division, the electric division, our IT folks, and other city staff, a proposed plan to make this change and the associated logistics was formulated. This was shared with the downtown board recently, and they gave generally positive feedback. So, you as a person parking in the lot, how will that work? Well, after you park your car, the driver will need to visit a kiosk to pay for parking. The new kiosk will take coins, cash, and credit cards. Much like meters now, they can select the time that they'll be in their location. The driver will then enter his or her license plate number to tie the payment to the vehicle. At this time, there are three kiosks that are planned for parking lot 2. This is, of course, the largest lot in the downtown area, so we'll see how the three works. We'll have some infrastructure in place should we need to add a couple more as it goes, but we'll observe it and see how it works out. And the eventual plan is to implement this new system in all of the city lots in coming years. As there may be questions about this change, if you're a downtown merchant or an interested citizen, the city and Downtown BG will be partnering to present information to downtown businesses, and again, anyone from the public interested who wants to learn more or ask questions. Information will be set up in the gallery at the Four Corners Center on Tuesday, June 28th, throughout the day. Folks are welcome to drop by and look it over. At 10, 2, and 6 that day, again on June 28th, representatives from the city and downtown will be available for questions or for further discussion. And that completes my report.
Other questions for Lori?
Lori, I have a question about the number of hours people can park in Lot 2 once you get the kiosks in. Will there be a section for only 2 hours and then a section for longer hours?
That is correct. At this time, as we do the transition, we plan to leave it the same, that the area that's now 2 hours, which is the area behind the businesses, and then kind of along the stone throw area, the part of that city that will remain 2 hour, and then the further out area is the 10 hour area.
Okay.
Where is the and on 28th.
Is at the Four Corner Center, which is the joint. What's your address there? 130 South or South Main? South, the old Huntington Bank, for those of us that have been around for a while. Or the Bank of Wood County, if you really want to get there.
Lori, I have a question about North College. I just noticed the other day an I-75 detour sign there, and I wonder if that has translated into a lot of trucks going over that road, and wondering if the road is designed to handle heavy trucks, and if there's damage and so forth, if ODOT participates in any repairs for that. I know Brian would be the one to ask, but I don't see him here.
Yes, Brian's not here this evening. I will note, I don't think we have anything specific for areas that may endure, the pressure from the I-75, which our community certainly has endured. But I will note that ODOT is a great community partner. We partner with them on all sorts of things in this town. A lot of times with funding to our advantage, 80-20 splits, especially with safety funding, 90-10 splits, those great, street signs that you see out everywhere, those big green ones, that was done through an ODOT program where, again, I think they paid 90% of it. So certainly they're a very good community partner, but watching the integrity of those roads will continue to be important, I think, for Public Works moving forward.
Okay. Thank you, Lori.
Thank you.
Parks and Recreation Director, Ms. Otley.
Okay, well, my joke every year, and I didn't get to say it at lunch in the park because I'm not the recreation coordinator anymore, so I didn't do the announcements, but doesn't matter what the calendar says, it's officially summer because the pool opened and the first lunch in the park happened. So the pool is open. It opened the Saturday of Memorial Day weekend, and for the first time ever, I think we actually had good weather all weekend, so that's great. Staff is on and up and going. As the mayor indicated, pretty much our summer programming has started. Camp started today. We had the first lunch in the park last Friday. Thank you, Mayor and Nadine, for guest serving. And we did have a great crowd. The first concert is this Sunday, the 12th. And I do have flyers for you guys on both of those. And lots more stuff going on all summer, way too numerous to mention, but you can always go to our website or ask me after, because I'm sure I have it all memorized. Let's see what else. This Thursday, our foundation is hosting a business after hours with the Chamber at City Park. So if you are a Chamber member, please plan on attending that. And I believe RSVPs are due to the Chamber tomorrow. That is, we are kind of focusing on the pool. So if you've been to a Chamber business after hours, there's appetizers, light appetizers and drinks, and we'll be kind of sharing some information on the pool and taking people over for behind-the-scenes tours of the pool if they would like. And the food will be from the pool concession stand. So we'll also kind of be promoting the fact that you can go in to the pool and get food from the concession stand. You do not have to actually attend the pool. You can go in and get that and exit. So if you're in the park and you're ever hungry or thirsty, please go in. There's lots of great food there. But that's this Thursday, 4:30 to 6, I believe, at the Veterans Building is where that'll mostly take place. This Friday, for the second time, and this year we are a sponsor of this, is Art in the Park, and we are co-sponsoring that with the Bowling Green Arts Council and a few other folks, and I'll pass some flyers out for that. It is 4:30 to 7:30 at Simpson Garden Park. There will be all kinds of activities going on throughout the garden park, and inside we'll have some children's activities put on by our department and the Montessori School of Bowling Green. And that is where we will be kicking off our project with Gail Christofferson, the Mosaic Glass Art Project that the Community Foundation has funded, the community art where the community puts that together, and there will be squares that will then eventually hang at the community center in those front windows to help with the sun coming in and blinding people during certain times of the year and day. So we're excited to kick that off. Building on Nature project is almost complete. I'm going to knock on some wood, hopefully next week, but they're very, very close to that first flush out there. Last but not least, first flush. I was thinking of raffling that off, but that may not be in good taste. So, last but not least, if you wondered if people watched this that WBGU so does a great job showing. The answer is yes, because the new owner of Dairy Queen was watching a council meeting, and I was promoting our Stone's Throw fundraiser for the foundation, and he called and said, hey, we just bought Dairy Queen. Would you like to have one there? And so I thought about that for about a second and said, yes. So on Monday, June 13th from 4 to 8, I'll give you a flyer, but you don't need one because he's actually going to give us 20% of sales for anyone who walks in during that time. So even if they weren't aware of this fundraiser, we will still get 20%. The Halleck family has long been users of the parks and longtime Bowling Green folk, and he said, I love the parks and I want to help out. So feel free to come out and visit Dairy Queen on Monday, June 13th between 4 and 8. And if that goes well, they may do a few more. So lots and lots and lots of other things going on, but you don't want to listen to me all night. So I am done unless you have questions for me.
Questions for Kristen. Thank you very much. City Attorney, Mr. Marsh.
I don't have a report. This is Brian Kraft. Sensational over the Memorial Weekend. Look fantastic.
I agree, Mike. I think the staff continuously does a great job maintaining that
piece of property, and we should all be proud of their efforts because it really is something to be proud of. I mean, it just always looks in order and is kept neat, and those guys really work very hard at it. So thanks for bringing that up. Utilities Director, Mr. O'Connell. Questions for Brian. Thank you. Okay, moving on to the introduction of new legislation.
Mr. President.
Mr. McComber.
From the Finance Committee, I have a resolution transferring previously appropriated funds.
Thank you, Bob. I have two ordinances from the Public Utilities Committee. First of all, an ordinance authorizing the Utilities Director to accept a utility easement for Meyer Distribution Incorporated. And also an ordinance authorizing the Utilities Director and or the Mayor to transfer approximately 2.3 acres of land in Bellard Business Park to the Bowling Green Community Development Foundation in lieu of dues for economic development purposes and declaring an emergency. Do we have any council committee reports this evening? Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Gordon, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. From the Community Improvement Committee, we have a resolution authorizing the filing of a proposal and or an application with the Ohio Department of Transportation for grants through the U.S. Department of Transportation Federal Transit Administration as authorized under federal transit laws as codified 49 U.S.C. Section 5311. Financial assistance for other than urbanized areas and funds available from the Ohio Public Transportation Grant Program, executing a contract or grant for the fiscal year 2017 Ohio Elderly and Disabled Transit Fare Assistance Program, and executing a contract with the Ohio Department of Transportation upon grant proposal and or application approval.
Thank you, Daniel. Now I will ask if we have any council committee reports this evening.
Mr. President, Bruce, you have something?
Go ahead.
Okay. Mr. President, for the Community Improvement Committee, while we're still sending feedback to the administration about revising our ordinance regarding refuse collection, we'd like to pencil in a follow-up meeting to the meeting we had previously. Kay, I believe we have June 20th at 6:30 available?
Yes, we do.
Okay, I'd like to set it for then. Thank you. And that's it for me.
Thank you, Daniel.
Mr. President, from the Planning, Zoning, and Economic Development Committee, I'd just like to report that we have completed our interviews with consultants for the strategic housing analysis, and we had three really good possibilities, and we did decide on one that we would like, and now it's up to Mrs. Treader to work out a contract with this firm. And so I just wanted to let you know that we are moving forward with this. And we were a little sneaky in that we asked questions from the people that we did not select, that we were glad to get their answers and input for free. So I guess that's just part of the deal. But anyway, we got a lot to work on and looking forward to getting started with that.
Thank you, Bruce. We have other council committee reports. Seeing none at this time, we will open the floor to lobby visitation. At this time, we invite anyone in attendance this evening to address council on any agenda item or any other piece of business pertaining to the city of Bowling Green. If you are interested in addressing council, we ask that you approach the microphone and clearly state your name and address for the record.
I've never used this before, so. Hi, my name is Will Pierce. I'm the GM of the Jimmy John's here downtown Bowling Green. The address is 215 East Wooster, Suite 1. I am here because I am having a fundraiser on Saturday for military personnel and military vets. We are trying to raise money to try to help with military family who are having issues with paying for essential needs, say, their transmission breaks down in their car or something along those lines and they can't afford to pay for it. There is a organization called the Family Readiness and Warrior Support. They're working with all the money that we are raising is going straight to them, and they take 100% of the profits and give it to a local, I think it's the American Legion. I'm not exactly sure on that one, but they hold the money for them, so whenever they need it, they give it to the family members, same as gift cards or gas money, anything along the lines that anybody needs. So we're trying to raise as much money as humanly possible to try to better assist these people who have been more than willing to sacrifice everything they have for us. The fundraiser is Saturday at 5 p.m. It goes until 9 p.m. We are also going to have a admission at the door, the $1 admission. That would give you all the free food you want from Jimmy John's and DP Dough. They are also helping with this. We are going to have gift bags for our tournaments that we are having. We are going to have a cornhole tournament outside, a live DJ, a water pong tournament in our back parking spots. We are also going to have a guessing game inside, a trivia game, and bingo and 50-50 raffle. Everything that we receive that night is going straight to the organization. If you do not want to give cash and you have extra gift cards laying around that you do not use, we are also accepting those as a form of payment for anything. Every game you play or every tournament you enter, there is an admission fee. It varies on which game you play. But everything that you are willing to donate, we'd be very appreciative of, and hope to see you all there. I didn't realize how many people were going to be here, and I only brought like 6 of these. So I have about 1,000 more in my store right now that I'm going to start mailing out with every delivery bag. So I apologize if you see a bunch of these things the next week. If the city council would like any of these, you're more welcome to take them. But yeah, it has all the information that you need on there. It does not say how much all the events cost because I didn't have numbers at the time when I first made the flyers. So if you have any questions, please speak with me about it, and I'll be able to go through it with you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Will. That sounds like a really great event. Hopefully it's well attended, and we certainly appreciate your participation in the community and everything that you do to help. Repeat the day and time for us again. 5 to 9. Great. Thanks.
You're up.
I'm Carol Kinsey. I live at 1047 Lindenwood. I'm just asking out of curiosity about follow-up from a previous idea that there would be a public forum about the green space issue. I'm just curious if there's any development in that idea.
There is no development in that, quite honestly.
Okay.
At this point in time, I think that we've chosen to hold pad on that pending some conversations that are taking place between mayor and administration officials attempting to make sure that we are making every effort to identify all of the alternatives that could be available to the city as it relates to a location of a new administration building. So we're attempting to work those conversations to hopefully a good outcome. But in the meantime, we're just going to kind of pull off a little bit, be patient, with the understanding that there's great interest in developing that space up there, you know, in some fashion of a community gathering space. We get that. We understand that. We're continuing to try to be patient, do our due diligence, and make sure that we make the right decision as opposed to maybe a quick decision.
Maybe so, down the road there will be public meeting, or maybe it'll be felt that's not necessary.
We're keeping all options open at this time. We're really focused on identifying all of the alternatives that could be available to us. Thank you.
Mike, on that note, is this still in the hands of all of council, or is it in the hands of a committee, the issue as to whether or not to put another building there? I guess I should be asking Teresa, but I wanted to ask you as president.
Yeah, so far it's been running through public lands.
Right, and my understanding is that after further due diligence is done and further examination of the alternatives is done, then we would be having a committee meeting that would invite public input, is my understanding of how this is going to progress.
Okay, so it's will be out of the hands of city council at some point and into a committee.
It'll be running, it'll be running through
committee and then come back
then
to us again.
To the full council.
Right.
Correct.
Okay. I know there's been a lot of people asking questions now that the weather's good and people are outside and we're seeing one another. There's a lot of interest in where are we, what's going to happen. So maybe it would be good to put that on our website or something just to keep people aware that we haven't forgotten about it and it's still on the plate, but there's more to do. Thank you.
Thanks, Sandy. Are there any others that are interested in addressing City Council this evening? Great. Seeing none, we will move forward with the reading of legislation.
Legislation for first reading. Resolution number 3628 for first reading. Resolution transferring previously appropriated funds.
Mr. President.
Mr. McComber.
I move to suspend the rules and give resolution 3628 its second and third readings.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Kay, would you please call the roll?
Gavarone.
Yes.
Gordon.
Yes.
Jeffers.
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes. The motion passes. The rules are suspended for resolution 3628.
Resolution number 3628 for second and third reading. Resolution transferring previously appropriated funds.
Mr. President.
Mr. McComber.
I move to adopt resolution 3628.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Okay, would you please call the roll?
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gavarone?
Yes.
The motion passes. Resolution 3628 is adopted.
Resolution number 3629 for first reading. Resolution authorizing the filing of a proposal and or an application with the Ohio Department of Transportation for grants through the U.S. Department of Transportation Federal Transit Administration as authorized under federal transit laws as codified 49 U.S.C. Section 5311, financial assistance for other than urbanized areas and funds available from the Ohio Public Transportation Grant Program, executing a contract or grant for the fiscal year 2017 Ohio Elderly and Disabled Transit Fare Assistance Program, and executing a contract with the Ohio Department of Transportation upon grant proposal and or application approval. Ordinance number 8519 for first reading. Ordinance authorizing the utilities director to accept a utility easement from Meyer Distribution Incorporated. Ordinance number 8520 for first reading. Ordinance authorizing the utilities director and or the mayor to transfer approximately 2.3 acres of land in Bellard Business Park to the Bowling Green Community Development Foundation in lieu of dues for economic development purposes and declaring an emergency.
I move to suspend the rules and give ordinance 8520 its second and third readings.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Kay, would you please call the roll?
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
The motion passes. The rules are suspended for Ordinance 8520.
Ordinance number 8520 for second and third reading, ordinance authorizing the utilities director and or the mayor to transfer approximately 2.3 acres of land in Bellard Business Park to the Bowling Green Community Development Foundation in lieu of dues for economic development purposes and declaring an emergency.
I move to adopt an emergency clause for Ordinance 8520.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Kay, would you please call the roll?
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
The motion passes. The emergency clause is adopted for Ordinance 8520. I now move to approve Ordinance 8520.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? I would just comment the reasoning for the expedited process on this particular ordinance is to allow the transfer to take place so that the development project can begin in a timely fashion. Kay, would you please call the roll?
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
The motion passes. Ordinance 8520 is adopted.
There's no legislation for second reading, so legislation for third reading. Ordinance number 8515 for third reading, ordinance authorizing the utilities director to apply for and execute an agreement for a loan through the Ohio EPA and or OWDA Water Supply Revolving Loan Fund Program for microfiltration membrane expansion at the water treatment plant.
I move to adopt Ordinance 8515.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Kay, would you please call the roll?
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
The motion passes. Ordinance 8515 is adopted.
Ordinance number 8516 for third reading. Ordinance authorizing the utilities director to request qualifications and enter into a contract or contracts for engineering services and to advertise for bids and execute a contract or contracts for the construction of the microfiltration membrane expansion at the water treatment plant.
I move to adopt Ordinance 8516.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Kay, would you please call the roll?
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes. The motion passes. Ordinance 8516 is adopted.
Ordinance number 8517 for third reading. Ordinance authorizing the utilities director to advertise for bids and enter into a contract or contracts for the purchase and installation of an automatic transfer switch for the water treatment plant.
I move to adopt Ordinance 8517.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Kay, would you please call the roll?
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
The motion passes. Ordinance 8517 is adopted.
Ordinance number 8518 for third reading. Ordinance vacating certain right-of-way in the vicinity of North College Drive and Bowling Green State University.
I move to adopt Ordinance 8518.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Can we have an explanation of what it is? It's vague. No, I don't need to know the details, but... I guess just why is it vague?
This is the area between Mary Street and then heading in towards campus that essentially BGSU is using anyway. As we started to look at it, truthfully, they were maintaining the road. They were doing everything with the road because it's encompassed in campus. It's not going to be used as a thoroughfare anymore with Ridge Street and that new lot that's being there. And it's just safer for pedestrians just to have that be open. We've retained, utility easements where it's necessary, but all of our staff got together with the university staff, and we decided that was just better for snow removal, for street maintenance, for safety reasons to turn that portion over to BGSU to manage.
That makes it clear. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Lori. Is there any further discussion? Okay, would you please call the roll?
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
The motion passes. Ordinance 8518 is adopted.
Do we need to move to take the other ordinance off the table, Kay?
Yes.
Okay. I move to remove ordinance, resolution, I'm sorry, 3622 from the table.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Okay, would you please call the roll?
McComber?
Yes.
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gaverone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
The motion passes. Resolution 3622 is removed from the table.
I move to adopt resolution 3622.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Well, a couple things I would like to point out regarding this, of course, is the parks levy that will appear on the November ballot. I think this is the final piece of legislation that council has to consider for that levy to appear on the ballot. So really, we're pretty much done with it, and it'll be up to the levy committee to get it passed after this. But and of course, I'm sure all council will support it. But this is our last official action in regard to the levy. And I guess there's two things I'd like to emphasize. One, first has been stated before, but this, as most of you in the audience probably realize, is a combination of continuing a levy that has been in effect for a number of years, and then additional money is being requested also. And both parts are being combined into a single levy. This is our one and only chance to pass this levy for the Parks Department. And if it were not to pass, they not only would not get the additional money, but they would lose about $600,000 that they've been getting for a number of years. Makes up something like 30% of their budget. It would be a pretty much a disaster from the Parks Department's standpoint. Certainly, I hope that people will support this levy and recognize that it's not just a matter of supporting additional funding, but it also makes up a good portion of the Parks Department budget currently, and will continue to do so. The second thing I wanted to bring up is, I guess over the years, and Mike, you've been involved in a lot of levies because of your service on the school board also, besides ones we've had on city council. I think I've been involved in about six levies overall between those two forms of service. And it's been my sort of observation that the one thing that is most detrimental to passage of a levy is if the public doesn't understand what additional money being requested is going to be used for. Or running a close second, if the entity putting the levy on the ballot does not have complete agreement within that organization as to what the money is going to be used for. And to emphasize that point, Kristen, I would ask you, if I understand correctly, in terms of the additional money, this will all be used for maintenance purposes, either to maintain property, catch up with deferred maintenance that should have or could have occurred earlier, but we just didn't have the money for it, or anticipated maintenance in future needs, right? That's 100% of the additional money going to that purpose. Yeah, okay. Hope the public understands that this levy has nothing to do with creating additional parks or additional services or expanding the park system in any way. We simply need more money to take care of what we already have. And that's the purpose of asking for the additional money. And just want to be sure everybody's on the same page about that. And if anybody has any questions or a different opinion, now would be the time to speak up, because this is the last time we're gonna discuss this matter publicly. I think when you can particularly consider, I think the public is more receptive overall to maintaining properties that you have than additional requests for money for new services, generally speaking. And this is critically needed additional money to properly maintain the properties that we already manage and provide services to the public with.
Mr. President, I'd like to thank Bob for bringing this up. It's extremely important to make it crystal clear what this money is being used for. I couldn't agree more, and thank you very much, Bob. The Parks and Recreation Department has done a fabulous job, but they have grown by leaps and bounds. And, you know, to be honest, we're probably overdue for asking for an increase in our levy amount. And that's why it becomes so vital that this be passed at this time. But, we have grown. We've added one park. We've added the new swimming pool, which was paid for by a levy. But the staff has increased. many, many more people on staff because we've had so many more people enjoying City Park and the pool. And our acreage for walking space and enjoying native fauna and flora has risen tremendously. But the number of people working at the park has just not changed to take care of all of that. So this is purely for maintenance, and I hope when people ask us questions that we're all well-equipped to answer them, that this is what it's going to take to just maintain our wonderful parks and rec system. Yes, we are doing surveys to see what people want in the future, but that's going to be used in the future. It's a five-year plan, and we're just now starting to think where we might go in the future, but it's going to have to be maintenance to get caught up. The one thing we don't want to have is lots of park space, park acreage that is not taken care of. The only good park to have is one that's well taken care of. So that's what's going to happen with this money, and we just need to be clear on that.
I don't have anything new to add to that, so I just want to say that I support fully what you both said, and just want to make sure everybody understands that we are just asking for money to maintain what we already have.
Like Bruce, I don't have anything new to add. I would just want to emphasize the importance of this levy. You know, when I talk to citizens about our park system, what I hear over and over again is a sense that people feel that our park system is one of our crown jewels here in Bowling Green. And so I think it's very fitting that we have our slogan, Parks Make Life Better in Bowling Green. When I think back to when Ridge Park opened last fall, with all the kids running around and smiling, I remember Mayor Edwards reported in after that time to council, and he said, you can't put a price tag on that. And I just hope that all of our citizens are mindful of that when they go to the polls in the fall, to recommit themselves and our community to support our amazing park system and keep us going 5 years into the future.
Yes, and I want to reiterate that I know there are some buildings that are in dire need of repair, like the Veterans Building over there at City Park. And it is really important that we do maintain the buildings and the parks that we already have. We've got a wonderful park system, and it's important that we keep it that way.
Thank you all for your comments. Very appropriate and informational. I would just like to add that I also strongly endorse this levy request and look forward to an opportunity to have a conversation with our residents, making them aware of all of the long-term maintenance need and in many cases long deferred maintenance needs in our park system. For a long time there has been maintenance that has been long needed but has been deferred simply because of our the financial situation. So in some of these instances we really are getting to a point where action is becoming critical for us to save some of these some of our resources within our park system. So again, I look forward to having a conversation with people in the community, making them aware of all of the benefits of the parks and hopefully demonstrating clearly the need for everybody in our community to reinvest in the parks. So thank you all very much. Okay, would you please call the roll?
Roland?
Yes.
Osbacher?
Yes.
Gavarone?
Yes.
Gordon?
Yes.
Jeffers?
Yes.
McComber?
Yes.
The motion passes. Resolution 3622 is adopted. Is there any other business to come before council this evening?
Might have a brief word here. I just want to thank you very much, members of council, for your consideration of the park levy. I really appreciate the time and effort that you put into this and asking all the right kinds of questions on behalf of your constituents, on behalf of the citizens of Bowling Green. You raised some very, very fundamental questions there, and I think in each of you, in your own way tonight, put the emphasis on that we don't have the funds to be doing a lot of additional things, but trying to take care of what we have. In that process, there's been one very important aspect of our park system, and that's the volunteer element. And so often I don't hear much about, you know, the volunteers and how important that is, again, to use your words that you use my words then, if you can't put a price on that, of the help of the volunteers. And I see people working all the time at our various parks and clearing trails. And of course, I'm very familiar with Simpson Garden Park, and some of us have our own little garden plots there that we try to maintain. And I keep an eye on Ridge Park. I've tried to make a weekly tour around there and just check things out. So I have to nudge the neighbors over there just a little bit. Maybe you can help me, Daniel. Sometimes we need to take clippers out and maybe go around some of the things too, because our people, you know, really can't get off of the mowers and go around and do. And so there are little things that all of us can do to help in this overall process. But the factor of the volunteer and the volunteerism, the commitment by so many people in our parks, whether it's through doing little simple things and trying to take care of, or through their very thoughtful, much deeply appreciated gifts to our parks foundation, that really makes this whole enterprise go. And I would have to say, and I think you would all quickly agree with me, that when you go through, and I've been interacting like you have, I'm sure, with different groups and so forth that are asking about our national ranking, as being among small to medium-sized cities, we're in the top 10 as a family-friendly community. And when you think of Rockville, Maryland at number one, and Palo Alto, California, number 10, and there's Bowling Green, and there it's the company we keep. But a lot of that has to do with the kind of park systems that each one of you, in your own special way, has identified as being an important ingredient in our community here, and what makes it very distinctive, very special, and kind of, you know, you don't want to brag at all, but it does set us apart from any number of other communities. So there's been this commitment over the years, so I hope we can keep it going. But more importantly, I just want to thank you for the deliberative process there. I really respect all the kinds of questions that you've asked, the time that you put into it, and that others sitting out here have raised too, and that you've been, I think, very, very effective in responding to. And I want to thank the staff, and I especially want to thank the levy committee, and I know there are representatives here tonight. You can wave your hands if you wish. But they've been doing a lot of work, and as I mentioned to them before, and I think you kind of said it tonight too, now the heavy, Bob, the heavy lifting begins. So they do have a special challenge before them. And I never like to think of things as a slam dunk. This is, you know, whenever you go to the voters, you have to make your case, pave the way. And you've paved the way. Now it's time for them to really make the case and reinforce all the points that all of us have tried in various ways to state this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Is there other business to come before council this evening? Is there a motion to excuse member Mr. Zanfordino?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. The motion passes. Mr. Zanfordino is excused. Is there a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. The motion passes. We are adjourned. Thank you all very much.